Mihai, nice to see you here at the Cloud Hero Studios. Welcome.
Thank you for the invitation. It's great to be here.
It's super interesting that we've been working for an year, I think more than an year, and it's the first time we meet in person.
That's
quite nice, and people are asking me from time to time, do you manage to work remotely? Is everyone working in the office? And I tell them, look, we have customers that we've never seen. We work remotely with our customers, and that's a thing that made the pandemics very easy for us, remote working very easy for us. So
yeah, it's the same for us. We also have customers in the UK, and not only, who are paying quite a lot of money.
Okay.
And we've never seen them, only in calls. So it's amazing, I think, as an opportunity to be able to collaborate and sell digitally without needing to be in a specific territory. I think it's a great opportunity.
Yes, that's a great opportunity. So you said you had customers. I heard that you have a pretty interesting business, a startup named Jobful.
Yeah.
So can you tell us a bit about what is Jobful and how did you come up with this?
Sure. So the best way to describe Jobful is an end-to-end employment platform. And I think most cases people translate employment in recruitment, which is part of it. And in some cases, even synonyms. But what I mean to say is that employment as a process can happen in relationship with directly with an employer on their career platform that we can provide them through an intermediary like a recruitment agency.
Okay.
And we also deliver for them technology for their core business
within
the university for internships, for example, and their campus recruitment. So we also deliver for them. So I would sum up Jobful as tackling employment end-to-end in any use case. And that was the way we built the entire solution.
Okay, that's very interesting.
Yeah.
I never considered employment something that starts at the university and...
When you think of career as a subject, you usually think of where do I work, what's the job?
Yeah.
But you are actually having your own journey every single year when you decide I want to continue here, I want to do something else. And employment is part of this career processes.
All right.
And there's quite a lot that you can do here, from skilling, from prepping for the process itself. You can do optimization in terms of how you communicate your value as a professional through the resume. So there's quite a lot, but in general, the market over the last 20 years, our market, the one we addressed, has exclusively looked at the business process.
Okay.
So they've built technology in order to satisfy the employers. And even before the pandemic, that was a huge frustration for candidates, for professionals, because the only action that the sum of the experience for a candidate today, it's apply and wait.
Yes. Yeah.
That's what you can do in order to get a job. And we started looking at how can we bring all the insights we can see in social media and not only in terms of desirable technology, attractive, something you want to engage with in order to expand this journey of the candidate. So we added courses, you can learn new things. We added challenges, you can prove that you know something.
Okay.
We added the recommender AI in order to find specifically not the entire noise, but specifically the jobs you're looking for.
Yes.
So we diversified the experience for candidates.
Who's your customer? It's the candidate or the one who's recruiting?
So the candidate is the beneficiary.
Okay, the beneficiary, right.
The customer is still the employer. They are the ones that are paying.
Okay.
We're not in a mature market where the added value in relationship with candidates, it's actually something you can commercialize.
Okay.
It's still something free across the market.
Okay.
But at the same time, the candidate, it's actually the employer's customer.
Yeah.
So we're looking at that relationship, and part of our pitch, the vision is empower professionals.
Okay.
So the way we work with employers is that we actually create great experiences for their talent pools and their candidates in order to be more attractive and have more successful recruitment processes.
That's fabulous. Now I realize, listening to you, that the recruitment market, the job market, I think it's one of the largest markets in the world.
Because
everybody builds a career, starts somewhere, builds a career and goes through all those processes.
Yeah, if you look at staffing and recruitment market, which is part of the market, doesn't even include the HR tech, for example.
Yes.
It's above 300 billion.
Whoa.
Work is half of our life. That's I think work processes, it's not half of our market, so to say, but it's a lot.
Yes, that's fabulous. That's fabulous. Interesting that you tackle this business because I know you have a technical background. How did you came up with this idea, or how did you started looking at this industry?
We actually started a bit the other way around, I would say. So in general, investors, they, and we work with a lot of them, they come and say, don't do everything, do something small but great, and push that as fast as you can in the market. Yes. And I think that was true until some point, until the pandemic or maybe a couple of years after. So recently, I think what we can see as trend, and it's not what we can see, it's also what trends are telling us, is that technology goes into a direction of consolidated experiences.
Okay.
So maybe 5 years ago, the large enterprises, the large employers had one solution for screening, the best one. One solution for employer branding, the best one once again. One solution for applicant tracking system. But what they realized is that the operational burden of the recruitment team kills the productivity of having the best tools, but 10 of them.
Yes.
So the new trend now is a consolidated approach. And I can give you a great example with Regina Maria, the largest private clinics in Romania. They were using 5 or 6 different tools, one of them being SAP SuccessFactors, and they had constant volumes of recruitment. They have more than 1,000 jobs in parallel at any point of time.
Oh.
A huge team for recruitment and a lot of processes and ambiguity here and there. For them, the key message was from their side. They came to us and said, well, we don't want to use 10 different tools. We don't want to enter job platforms and job boards and LinkedIn and everywhere. We want to do something centralized, one experience, not only for candidates, but also for the recruitment team.
Yes.
And that's exactly what we did. And in the past 6-7 months since we launched, they are able to see the volume that they are processing through technology. They got to 37,000 profiles that they processed. And they were not able to see because some of them were here, some of them were here.
And they were not integrated.
They were not integrated and they were not able to see the funnel. Where do I leave candidates?
Yes.
Where do they drop off? Why are they dropping off? Where can I improve the processes?
Yeah.
So it's difficult to improve something if you don't know what's working and what's not working. And we help with that as well.
Yes. Yes, that's very interesting, very interesting. So what's your background? I mean, how did you started in this industry? How did you came up with Joful? What was the idea behind Joful?
So I have to admit, the idea came from a customer.
Okay.
prior to Joful,
okay,
maybe 8 years ago, we launched Playful Solutions.
Okay.
Which was an agency doing gamification for career services.
Okay.
Now, gamification is a buzzword. It sounds sexy, but nobody knows how to use it or to implement it. The better terminology is human-centered design.
Okay.
So gamification, what it tells you actually is, look, as an individual, as a human being, you have a couple of motivators. For each of these motivators, there are game techniques that can keep you engaged and make the entire thing attractive.
Okay.
And I'll give you a couple of examples. Black Friday.
Yes.
Limited time, 24-hour discounts, 3 game techniques applied. It's a gamification framework over there as well.
Okay.
Or another example is when you buy 5 coffees and the 6th one is for free.
Yes.
That's another gamification implementation.
Yes.
So we usually associate it with games and consider it's not for serious things.
Okay.
And at the same time, if we look at the gamification framework of LinkedIn, Facebook, TikTok,
to give you rewards as soon as possible. When you
it can be about rewards. It can be about progress.
Progress, yeah.
So you see the LinkedIn and it tells you you're 80%, but if you complete this information,
yes, you'll be 95.
You'll be 95.
Yeah,
that's
a
game techniques applied for a specific process.
Yes.
They want you to have the profile completed on the platform because it adds value for them.
Yes.
So instead of associating with games, we started looking at, well, we can make work fun. Uh-huh. That was the key idea.
Yes, I understand.
And we've done a couple of projects with Vodafone and different other mm-hmm. customers. We even gamified the wedding. It was amazing. Just the idea of, even in performance management, you have to do something and you have KPIs. Yes. But if you associate some intrinsic motivation and extrinsic motivation, getting a diploma or getting an award, you keep the same process, but you endorse it with motivation. Mm-hmm. That's what we were doing at that point of time. And one of the banks in Romania, actually an Italian bank in Romania, came to us and said, well, the reddest ocean, it's called recruitment. This is pre-pandemic.
Yeah.
If you can do something in recruitment, then I think the entire market will follow you. I think as a person, I resonate with tough challenges.
Yes.
So I said, of course, we're going to recruitment.
Yeah.
And that's when we pivot, 2017.
So you had a platform and you...
We had the framework,
okay.
But we were delivering that on Yammer or different other solutions.
Oh, okay.
We didn't have the technology.
You didn't have the technology.
Okay. When we pivot, we created a Joful as a technology mm-hmm. for recruitment as a marketplace.
Okay.
Then in 2020, when the pandemic hit, we were on high horses at that point of time, which means we were spending a lot. And the pandemic was a big negative hit in our cash flow.
Okay.
So we pivoted and said, well, what if instead of marketplace, a B2B2C model, we offer this as B2B for any company? And that's how we implemented mm-hmm. for Regina Maria, for example, and not only. And create a more sustainable model and scalable model. That's more or less a couple of years later, maybe one and a half, when we met.
Okay.
When
okay.
we started discussing.
That's very interesting. But so before Joful, you had Playful Solutions.
Yes.
Which was still in the career HR.
Yes, in HR.
Okay,
yeah,
in
yeah.
HR. And curious to see a bit the story behind this. How did you came up with HR and with this industry?
Okay. I get the question now. Yeah. I think me as a person and the founding team as well, my sister and the other two co-founders in the initial startup, all of us, are very passionate about people.
Okay.
And gamification has its largest impact where you work with people because you try to motivate them.
Yeah.
So people processes were always a priority
mm-hmm.
for us as individuals and for our expertise on gamification, because the best outcome you have when you motivate people.
Yes. That's interesting.
Yeah. It's a timeline. It's a very interesting timeline because when I started Playful, 2 months later, I got hired by Microsoft mm-hmm. in their enterprise sales team. They convinced me that this is a great opportunity, and it was. I learned quite a lot in terms of sales from Microsoft. 2 years later, when we launched Joful, I moved from Microsoft to SAP.
Okay.
And I was the sales manager for SuccessFactors, which was, I'm not sure if it still is, the largest HR platform in the world.
Okay, now
and I
see the connections.
Yeah. I was meeting the market, the HR leaderships, I was positioning technology, and when I was positioning, I was thinking, well, I think I can do a better job.
Yes. Yeah, definitely SAP, it's a difficult thing to sell, and if you manage to sell the SAP, then you can sell almost anything.
Yeah, it's difficult, but it has so much value, indirect value. Meaning that some organizations are buying SAP solutions because it increases their valuation. If they want to sell the company, implementing SAP
yes.
it's a great investment.
It's a great investment.
Because it translates to potential companies that can acquire them. It translates into a more mature organization with standard processes, which for them apparently means more value.
So now I'm thinking of a tip for startups, deploy SAP as soon as possible. Your
not
company lifestyle to increase, to increase valuation.
I'm not sure if it applies for startups.
Yes, I believe so. That's definitely SAP, it's a solution that shows maturity.
Yeah.
I've assisted some SAP deployments and they're very, very complex. So
yes, they are.
It requires a lot of maturity in order to deploy it.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
more than
in terms of
yes.
your own processes.
Yes.
If you don't have them
yes.
defined, then SAP comes and tells you, well, how would you like this process
yes.
of collaboration with hiring manager or whatever implemented? And if you don't have that answer, it means okay, we'll not implement this feature for you.
Yes. And you're paying a couple of thousand per day
yeah.
for consultants, and definitely you need to
cool. cool. To make the most of
you
it. Need, yeah.
Okay, now I make the connections interesting. So yeah. You did sales in the HR industry.
Yeah.
And this is how you saw the market potential with your alongside with your passion for people and.
Yeah, so the two journeys yes. in terms of entrepreneurship and my corporate life, so to okay. say, at some moment of time gave me a lot of confidence
yes.
that I have the knowledge, the background, the expertise, the resources and the network okay. to do something competitive to SAP.
Yes.
Which is not the
yeah, it's very
easy to
brave.
Process initially. It's brave.
Very,
yeah.
brave, brave, brave. Nice. Cool. So you have now a technical platform. So Jofuli, it's a software. It's
yeah.
a SaaS.
Yeah.
I'm curious a bit about the technology behind Jofuli mm-hmm. and how did you choose that technology in order to fulfill your business goals? How did you start with the tech stack and how it evolved?
Yeah. So in terms of tech stack, it wasn't really my decision. It was my decision, but not really.
Okay.
Meaning that I do I graduated in computer science, okay. so in theory I'm a developer, but I'm not. I'm a seller, okay, yes. as mentioned earlier, and a founder. But I would say that when we pivoted towards technology and started building Jofuli, I went to one of my initial mentors, one of the mentors I've been working with him, with Emil, for the past 10-12 years.
Okay.
It's actually my first employer.
Okay.
Who has a IT software development okay. agency company. And I worked, my first job was as project manager over there. Oh, so okay. I was building platforms for UK and US customers okay. and helping them build. And it was a frustration even before Microsoft.
Okay.
Why are we building technology for others and not for us? Because we know they are making a lot of money with these technologies. Why aren't we building these for us?
Okay.
So when we pivoted and started Jofuli, the very first person was Emil. And I told him, this is all the money we have from pilots and yes, what I have yes, in yes, the yes. bank from Microsoft and SAP, from my
yeah.
earnings. What can we do with this money as an initial version? And then we'll see how we'll continue it. And it was Laravel.
Okay.
In terms of framework with PHP and MariaDB. And I think at that point of time, the entire front end was standard. We were cutting pages, CSS,
yes.
page by page.
Yes.
We realized over time so many improvements. Today, for example, the front end, it's Tailwind. So we
okay.
work with libraries.
Okay.
It's more scalable, easier to customize,
okay.
easier to deploy for each customer. The backend is still Tailwind because the investment in the product.
It's still Laravel.
It's still Laravel.
Laravel okay.
Yeah. Sorry, it's still Laravel because the investment in the platform, I think it's over 1 million right now.
Okay, so it will be pretty expensive.
Yeah, it's a lot in the backend.
Does it scale? Because I heard a lot of people saying PHP doesn't scale, Laravel doesn't scale.
At that point of time, I would say it can scale, but it consumes a lot of resources.
Okay.
Because every single deployment meant another architecture, full architecture for the database,
okay.
for the application layer. So mm-hmm. we were replicated the infrastructure for every single customer.
Oh, so basically you are delivering your platform per customer tenant, so you are replicating.
Exactly.
Okay.
But we didn't have, and we still don't have, now we're working at this. We didn't
so it's
have,
not a shared tenant?
It's not a shared tenant.
Oh, okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
Now we're working
okay.
on multi-tenant.
Okay, multi-tenant.
In order to scale, to do product-led growth and
yes.
Yes. many other things. But
okay.
at that point of time, it was just take the entire machine
yes.
and replicate it. And it was time-consuming. When you work with multiple customers, you have multiple versions, so you start becoming closer to an agency than a product business.
Yes.
That's when we met. That's specifically when we met.
So I kind of now make the connections. So when you are saying time consuming, it was time consuming to replicate the environments, time consuming to release a new version of software. What was the challenge there?
So everything that you mentioned.
Okay, so everything.
Maintenance, bug fixing.
All right.
Every port process connected to our technology
right.
was doubling with every single customer.
All right.
Was multiplying with every single customer.
All right. So to give a bit of context, we've met because we have Cloud Hero, which is a DevOps professional services company and an AWS partner. And we've been working together in order to improve your infrastructure. So now I kind of see exactly how the stars aligned. There's a good point of meeting face to face as well.
Yeah.
Because you can see some things or discuss about some things that usually in calls which are time bound, you tend to be very efficient, but you might miss.
Yeah, I totally agree. We never spoke about how we got here. We only spoke about this is what we need and it's urgent and how can we make it happen and so on.
Well, I'm happy that things turn out well.
Yeah, me
and,
too.
And because if they wouldn't, then we wouldn't have been here.
So. Yeah. Fair enough.
So that's cool. All right. So you, at least working with us, you decided to migrate to AWS.
Yes.
So I believe now having the context that you had a per customer tenant and you need to replicate it and it was hard to maintain. Mm-hmm. You also needed some a cloud provider. Why did you decide to migrate to AWS? What was the, besides the let's say operational and maintenance challenges? Because you can,
I would say operational and maintenance challenges come second in as an answer. And I'm not sure your audience, but I'll be frank about it.
Yes.
It's costs. The infrastructure started piling up as a cost with every single customer.
Yes.
And both Microsoft and AWS have this programs for startups.
Okay.
And the way I look at this, it's I'm very happy that both of them exist.
Yes, yes.
Because it creates a competitive framework or landscape for tech providers or for founders like me who can benefit from their competition.
Okay.
And they have all sorts of programs in terms of credits, in terms of support services, mm-hmm. in terms of working with partners.
Yes.
They learned over time that a key to success is putting some effort and in some case money at the table for early stage founders.
Yes.
Because then they start building a relationship very early on. Just like venture capital is trying to do as well.
Yes.
Getting closer and closer to earlier stages.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, that's a quite interesting model. And at the end of the day, it's a strategy for making money for all of them.
100%.
But I think it pays off because they help you when you need.
Yeah.
And then they rip up the rewards as you grow. Of course, your infrastructure costs will grow and you'll be there. And if they provide an excellent service, then you won't have the need to move somewhere else. Also, having in mind that prices are about the same across all hyperscalers. So you pay the same amount of money regardless where you are.
Yeah.
But those programs make a difference. And as a company, I think close to 30% of our business comes from similar project like yours.
Okay.
We get money from AWS. I would not say we get money, but we leverage funding. So we can reduce the overhead of migrating or consolidating or improving or modernizing our customers' infrastructure. So if you are a small startup and, I don't know, migrating or building a scalable infrastructure will cost you X amount of money, sometimes we can get those money from AWS and offset the cost so you won't have to pay.
Exactly.
And that makes a difference. And on top of that, of course, we can help as we help you leverage access to credits and
I think
those.
At our end, we at that point of time, we couldn't afford everything we needed from your side.
Yes.
That's when Amazon came in and said, well, some of it I can contribute in order to make it happen.
Yes.
So I think it's a great model for everyone involved, for the ecosystem.
It's a great model, yeah, definitely. All right, so you decided to migrate to AWS. We came with the prepaid professional services, also with funding. Can you tell us how much funding you got from AWS? Can you share this?
Sure. I think initially we got on a program for 10K.
10K, that was in credits?
Yes, in credits.
Okay.
Then as a next stage, when we started migrating together, we got an additional 25K.
Okay.
And just 6 months ago, maybe five? I'm not quite sure.
Okay.
We got an additional 75K.
Okay, so in total you got 110K.
That's money that we
that's
didn't spend.
Exactly, that's money and you didn't give any equity for them.
Yeah, exactly.
That's super important.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, to get 100,000 from a VC to spend it on infrastructure, because I think most of the costs are on salary and infrastructure as
yes, business. Go to market, sales and marketing, headcount, if you need to expand the team, and infrastructure, because it's part of COGS, it's part of cost of goods.
Yes.
If every single customer consumes cloud resources, then you have a cost with infrastructure for every single customer.
All right.
How you optimize that, I think it's part of the art of building a profitable model.
All right.
That's profitability.
Yes.
How much less you have to pay the infrastructure as you scale, that's just as good as a pricing strategy. You can either increase the prices or lower your costs. It's still profitability.
It's still profitability, definitely, definitely. So you first looked at, okay, how we can consolidate on AWS, on the cloud, to fulfill our business requirements.
Yeah.
I think at that time you had to deliver some tenants for some customers, which you needed to replicate as soon as possible and maintain and make them reliable.
Yeah.
And after that, the credits came as a safety net because you didn't care so much about
how much we spend.
How much you spend, you care about more delivering to customers.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then in a couple of months, I think it was pretty soon after you delivered the service to the tenant, to the customer, you started looking at optimizing.
I think it was in parallel.
In parallel, yes. Yeah. You know, that's one of the advantages of the cloud, because the cloud is not for everyone and it's very expensive.
Can be.
Can be very expensive.
Yeah.
And sometimes it makes sense to have your own servers or to have your own infrastructure or go to like a smaller hosting company. But also it has the advantage that it's built by the hour. And if you know how to manage resources and to optimize them and to consume them when you need, not to keep them on just because, it's very, very cost efficient.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I can give you our example.
Okay.
So our example goes something like this. When we were replicated the entire infrastructure, we were doubling, we were multiplying a cost, which was between 800 euros and 1,000 euros.
Okay.
So it was significant. Just think of how expensive can a solution for employment be in order to cover a minimum of 1,000 cost in infrastructure per month.
So the subscription should be a couple of thousands. So,
exactly.
Many thousands. Yeah.
In our specific case, when we started migrating, it was actually customer request. It's an enterprise customer, it's a bank.
Okay.
And they said, we have policy from the group. We can work with cloud SaaS solutions if that cloud is Amazon.
All right.
So it wasn't option, you can choose your own servers, you can choose a different provider. No, it was
AWS.
Or on-premise, but on-premise is not really an option.
On their premises.
On their premises, yeah. But it wasn't really an option.
Yes.
It was like, if needed, maybe, but we'll work 1 year just to make it happen. Because you have access to their employees, you have access to interactions, you have access to their HR information system. It's not easy as a startup to get from an enterprise customer that degree of access.
Yes.
You need a lot more confidence and history in order to be able to do that. So we went for AWS. That was one of the greatest advantage. What we've done in parallel together with you was to also put the entire solution on Kubernetes.
Yes.
So we can replicate the pods, so we can have on the same infrastructure, which is after we optimized it together, it's around 800 euros.
Yes.
And we can keep 32 customers.
All right.
Which would have been above 25K.
So basically, we migrated from having a per server tenant to a per namespace or...
Exactly. I think.
So the isolation now, it's at a namespace level. You have Kubernetes, which optimize resources even more.
Exactly. Right. And that was one chunk, which, as mentioned, it's a 20x improvement on
20x.
Cost, at least, if not above. Yes. The second one was our discussion with your colleague about hot instances, for example.
Spot instances, ephemeral instances.
What we realized that we have an algorithm that consumes a lot of resources, machine learning algorithm for recommender AI, which is crunching all the
data. It's running jobs.
Jobs and resumes.
No, jobs as in batch jobs.
Oh, yeah,
exactly. You have a different
terminology for job.
Jobs. Yeah.
Yeah, so in our case, it was running all the profiles and all the jobs and behind the scenes, looking at a skill graph in order to see similarities and so on. And just to keep that instance constantly alive as we were doing before, it was more than the entire solution in terms of resources.
Yes.
And we realized that doing recommendation doesn't need uptime 100%.
Yes.
It actually needs some slots where they process with all the resources and then they send the recommendations to our solution that it's sending over to candidates and to recruiters.
Yes.
And that was another layer of optimization, which was, again, could have doubled our costs. And with hot instances, it was marginal.
Yes, spot
instances.
Spot instances. Spot instances are a news capacity that AWS provides you if nobody requests for it. If they request it on demand, then they will notify you with 1 minute in advance and they will kill your instance.
And they are super cheap.
They are, I don't know, up to 80% cheaper than on demand. So that's the price, it's unbeatable. I mean, you cannot find those type of resources that cheap. And yeah, the idea with Kubernetes is that you can dies before it finishes, then it can be re-executed and Kubernetes can discuss with AWS, has a driver that knows how to spawn new instances.
Exactly.
And you can start new instances, different types. You can see where do you have capacity, what type of instances. You don't care so much if you take a small instance or a big instance. You can mix and run your processes on top of that, and then they will be shut down or killed.
Yeah, exactly.
So and that's fabulous. I mean,
we forgot about downtime since we have Kubernetes. Because if a pod, something happens, something, I don't know, something can happen within an application. Something happens, it just replicates the pod, it keeps the sessions. So it, for the end user, the term of downtime with the Kubernetes infrastructure, it's something irrelevant.
Yes, and you know, that's valid also for small companies and for large companies as well.
Oh yeah.
Mostly for large companies. We've been doing a lot of Kubernetes deployment in the enterprise sector. Mm-hmm. Actually, we did the first enterprise Kubernetes deployment for a telco before the pandemics. So,
oh, wow.
Yes, it was, they were very brave to do that. Nobody knew so much about Kubernetes. And still people are very scared, but I know you don't touch it. You see your colleague touching them, but do you find it or do you get the feedback that is difficult to manage or do you think it's something that...
I think in terms of, how can I put this?
I mean, what's the impact on developer productivity? Because that's what matters for you, I think.
I think it is some impact. I wouldn't call it marginal. I think developers in general, and especially people that we hire, they have this tendency of understanding everything behind the scenes in order to know how to operate. With Kubernetes, the story is a bit different, meaning that you don't know exactly how it works and what happens behind the scenes, but you trust that the documentation you're using will get you where you want to get. So you understand the logic behind, but you don't know because it's DevOps, it's a lot behind the scenes.
It's a lot.
And I think it's a way of developers trusting Kubernetes as a solution that they don't fully understand.
I mean, it's complex.
Yeah.
But it's also very easy because it's basically an automated event-driven infrastructure orchestration tool. So it's like a crane that it's taking those containers and putting them on servers.
Yeah.
And the decision, it's based on events, like automated events or manual inputs from the command line. So at the fundamental level, it's very easy.
Yeah.
That's why it's so reliable. But it's built as an abstraction layer on top of servers to make it easier to use. All right, cool. Nice. So we had AWS. So you first migrated to AWS. Then you decided to modernize and implement Kubernetes, which increased availability and made things and also reduced costs.
Yes,
we are always encouraging customers to adopt Kubernetes regardless of their scale and infrastructure because it's reliable. Decent to use, not very complicated, but it brings a lot of value when you grow.
In terms of value, I yes. totally agree. Now we're looking at delivering, deploying multi-tenant on Kubernetes
yes.
as well.
Yes.
Because then you can have a shared database and consume even yes. less resources.
Yes.
So it's in terms of, if you're looking as a founder at a product-led growth strategy,
yes.
so you want to have a model similar to Slack or to HubSpot or
yes.
to different other solutions where you add value and it's a freemium or a free trial,
yes.
but then you have premium services. I think doing that without Kubernetes, it doesn't make sense in today's world.
It doesn't make sense. It's exactly. Kubernetes, it's just a layer of abstraction and an automation platform. And people were scaling a lot before Kubernetes,
yeah.
but they had to make their own tools.
True.
That's why Google invented Borg. Facebook had their own orchestrator system.
Yeah.
And now Kubernetes, definitely it's a game changer. Yeah.
Totally agree.
I'm curious a bit. Our biggest competitors are not our competitors, are when companies, when customers decide to hire internally.
Yeah.
And our mission is to be the go-to solution for teams up to two DevOps. Because
okay.
there's a reasoning behind that, you know. It's having a DevOps team requires to have a good understanding on what DevOps means. So you need to have a DevOps culture. You need
yeah.
to have a good understanding on how system works. You need to have enough workload to give to that team. And we've seen that, we are constantly investing in building tools to help our engineers become more productive, which turns out to better quality for our customers and better services for our customers.
Yeah.
When you have a team larger than two, then it might make sense for you to have your own DevOps manager, to have your own DevOps team lead, to make it internally.
Yeah.
How did you decide not to hire somebody and work with a external partner on doing that?
I think there are two nuances to the decision.
Okay. Yeah, be very honest.
The first one, just to place me between risk adverse and super high risk profile,
okay.
I'm risk tolerant.
Okay. Okay.
So I usually, my decisions are mostly having a component of risk,
okay.
which I perceive as opportunity.
Okay.
But I'm tolerant with risk, that's the main idea.
Okay.
So this is the part where for me, it was simple to say, well, between a DevOps and an external team, how much of a full-time do we need?
Yes.
And it wasn't a full-time, so it doesn't make sense in terms of
yes.
cost. And when I say risk tolerant, what I'm not tolerant in terms of risk is, can this become a single point of failure?
Yes.
And I would rather rely on the expertise of a company who does this every single day for multiple customers
yes.
than one person who might have the expertise, might have the productivity or the time to take care of everything. But it's still one person.
Yeah.
So I would rather have 10 hours from your team with 20 people who know every single use case, every single challenge, every single contact in AWS, support, tickets, everything
yes.
that is needed, even though per hour is more expensive, because the risk of single point of failure within the team, which can affect our customer base and implicitly our entire business, that's too big of a risk from how I see the
yes.
the things working. So my tolerance to risk is I'd rather have expertise where I don't know or I don't have resources in the team, and it's a big topic that we don't want to prioritize because we don't want to build the DevOps teams. It's not a priority. We're doing technology, so our priority is technology.
Yeah.
And expertise in our industry,
yes.
recruitment, employment, and so on. So it's not the only type of collaboration in this format. I'll give you an example and you'll understand how easy
okay.
it was the decision for me. We do the same for legal.
Okay.
So when we work on contracts, on investment, on
yes.
from a legal perspective, well, we want to have the expertise and we want to have the stamp of someone saying, if something goes bad, I'm responsible.
Yes.
And I have the expertise on helping you with everything
yes.
that you need. It's just the same.
Yeah.
Accounting, just
yes.
the same. So for us, it's DevOps and the relationship with the cloud provider, it's hygiene.
Yeah.
It's something that cannot go wrong. And we prefer to leave some of these things that we don't have expertise and cannot go wrong to the people we trust that know to... how can I put this? It's not that we'll be free of any challenges, because that's not the case. Yeah. But I'm confident that any challenges that might arise, you know how to tackle them.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you for your trust.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. I mean, infrastructure is something critical. You know, people, you don't tend to see it. You know, nobody buys the servers that run Joful. You know, but if the servers goes down, somebody will call you and tell you the application is not working.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, infrastructure has a very interesting and important position in a life of a business.
Yeah.
You cannot be with it, but you don't see it, so...
It's critical and in some cases underrated.
Underrated, yeah. All right, cool. Do you remember how did you find us? I never asked you this. Or how did you get in contact with us?
I think Amazon recommended you.
Oh, okay. That's a very good... I didn't know that.
Amazon is present at every single incubator, accelerator, and so on. We've been part of SAP.io in Berlin.
Okay.
2019, and we met with their team and they told us about Activate, their program, and how to work with them and so on. And I made a friend at that point of time from Amazon. Okay. We were just exchanging. We told them, well, currently, we're not on Amazon, we're on a different technology. And they said, well, in order for you to understand the capabilities, what we can do, how we can help and so on, just to make a decision, I can put you in touch with one of our great partners from Romania, because they are also present in the local market. You can speak with them in Romanian if you prefer. Yeah. And from their end, for me, it was a surprise. They recommended full trust without trying to control the relationship. So they said, go and talk with Andrei. I'm sure you'll do great things together. End of story, so to say.
Cool. All right. Nice. So that's quite a interesting and intense story. Thank you so much for taking your time to share it.
Sure.
And I hope people will get some learnings and startups will have a good understanding on what other type of finance programs exist besides VC money.
Yeah,
because getting 100K, it's quite impressive. And maybe we'll have the chance to talk again.
Yeah, sure. It would be my pleasure. I would just add that these programs are actually a different system for debt capital.
Yes.
It's still a cost that you're not paying. It's debt capital. If you look at it as capital, then you might prioritize working on how to optimize your costs and infrastructure because it makes sense for profitability, sustainability, and the future of your business.
Yeah, definitely. We have a customer that was struggling with money after the pandemics and optimizing infrastructure cost. They were at a very big scale. So infrastructure cost was in the range of millions per year.
Wow.
So optimizing 30% of infrastructure cost made the difference between losing money and becoming profitable. So, yes.
You were a life jacket.
we it was a nice experience working with them, so definitely. Cool. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.